These series of videos are demonstrating how to automate economic policy through code. A link to the GitHub repository is included in the video description. In the previous video, we learned how to locate, develop, and test the GraphQL service. In this video, we're returning to the rules service for a thorough explanation of what it does, show how to test a request, and how to develop it. There are a few changes as of March 2023. 1. The rules service was rewritten in Rust because it will be a very busy service and needs all the horsepower it can get. 2. The rules service was renamed. It is now the rules service, no longer plural. We'll stick to using a local editor, but the option to develop from a browser remains available. Okay, open a terminal and spin up your compose stack with make compose up. We'll test a request first, then explain how the code produces the response. Navigate to your in-editor HTTP client, and from the Collections tab, select GraphQL and the rules with approver's request. Hit send. We'll pull out the request and response into their own tabs for convenience, and open the code alongside it to help tell the story. The entry point for the rule service may be found under Services, Rule, Source, and main.rs. There's some rough code in here, with excessive querying and functions getting called inside other functions. It's neither optimal or test-friendly. But to keep cadets from going cross-eyed during story time, we're avoiding as much code golf and boilerplate as possible. Starting here with a request, it's saying Joe Carter, the debitor, or customer, brought some milk, bread, and eggs to the grocery co-store counter, or creditor. The person at the counter created this request and sent it to the rules service. Now let's switch to the code. Scroll down to the main function. A health check route is created, a Postgres connection pool, then the service route. The handler for the service route is called apply rules. The rest of main is just firing up a web server, so we'll move on to the apply rules definition. Apply rules is passed the database connection pool along with the requested transaction items. The values in the request are tested, and then a mutable role sequence is defined. Users can decide to apply rules to the debitor or creditor first. So that's a role sequence. A mutable version of the transaction item list is created. Some defaults are set. And then apply rules learns whether the user wants to apply rules either debitor or creditor first. A database connection is grabbed from the pool. And here comes the first important feature contained in this apply transaction item rules function. This function references the data in the request to query for transaction item rules. Our tax is required. Is the grocery co-store owner paying a debt service with every transaction? You get the idea. Moving up to apply transaction item rules. When it's passed the transaction items, the function first lists all the accounts they reference. Joe Carter. Grocery Co. Then fetches their account profiles. You'll find a Rust type for an account profile from Project Root, under Crates, Types, Source, and Account. Don't mind the public fields. Getters and setters will be added later. You see state name? We'll use that field shortly. After account profiles are fetched, a mutable variable of transaction items is created. It starts out as an empty list, but it'll eventually receive the initial and rule-added transaction items. This is the list that's returned to the user. or the grocery co-store counter person who sent the request. The function then begins looping through transaction items, clones each transaction item as mutable, and creates another empty list for all the rule-added transaction items that will be added along with it. For example, milk is the current transaction item, and rule-added items such as taxes are added along with it. Now the function begins a nested loop through the role sequence, debitor-creditor, or vice versa. The debitor or creditor account in the transaction item is matched. If we're working on the debitor, it's Joe Carter. If we're working on the creditor, that's Grocery Co. Then the account is matched with its profile. The account profile ID is then attached to the transaction item. Since the user doesn't send those, the profile ID fields start out as empty. A profile ID of 1 for Joe Carter, the debitor, and a profile ID of 29 for Grocery Co., the creditor. Next, the profile of the current account is used to query for any rules required by the state. This is where the state name field in the account profile is used. Now, if the list of state rules is not empty, the function loops through the rules and applies each rule to the current transaction item. Said in plain English, if you're selling milk for $2 at your Grocery Co. store in California, the rule service will find a rule, apply that rule to the milk item you're selling, and increase the list of things you're selling to include a 9% tax transaction item for 18 cents. And congratulations, this means you no longer have to estimate and save for your quarterly state tax liability, because it was computed and collected for you at the time of sale. Anyway, the loop will perform the same for the bread and the eggs. Other transaction item rules may be queried and applied, like matching city taxes in the account profile, or an automated dividend triggered by a minimal earnings threshold. This is transaction automation. Skipping to the end of this function, the initial and rule-added transaction items are added to the response, and the response is returned. Let's move back down to where it was called in the Apply Rules handler. Next, a global approval time is created, which is used to automate approvals. Now comes the second important feature in the form of this Apply Approval Rules function. Moving up to its definition, when it's passed the initial and rule-added transaction items, the Apply Approval Rules function loops through them, creates an empty list of approvals for each transaction item. So it looks like this at the beginning, empty. Then for each debitor and creditor account in a transaction item, that's the role sequence. It gets the name of the account, then queries the account's owners or approvers. For example, the state of California is the creditor in this transaction item, and the rule service went looking for everyone who owns that account. It found Ben Ross, Dan Lee, and Miriam Levy. These are the owners or approvers of the State of California account. Back in the code, the Apply Approval Rules function loops through the approvers. An empty mutable approval is created for each. Notice the approval time starts out as empty. Then approval rules belonging to each account is queried. And yes, you can get all the rules at once, but this is story time, and fetching information at the time it's used preserves context for cadets. Now, if the account owner has an approval rule automating their approval, and they can have more than one, specifying conditions on values and transaction items, the current rule in the loop, applies the approval timestamp created by the rule service as the approval time to the approval. So in this case, the rule service found a rule owned by Ben Ross and approved the transaction item for him by applying this timestamp. An approval rule was also found for Dan Lee and Miriam Levy. But the rule service did not find an approval rule for Joe Carter, the debitor, or customer. So he'll have to approve manually, probably from his mobile while standing at the grocery co-store counter. After all the debitor and creditor approvals are added, the approvals list is then attached to this single transaction item. That's here. And the loop continues until all transaction items have their own list of approvals. That's the end of the apply approval rules function. It's not there yet, but error handling aside, apply approval rules doesn't return anything. It just modifies the transaction items it was passed by first adding empty approvals for each account owner, and then their rule edit approval times. Back to the apply rules function where it was called. If all creditor approvals have timestamps, the label approved transaction items function stamps the transaction item as approved by the creditor. Creditor approvers Ben Ross, Dan Lee, and Miriam Levy all have approval timestamps. So the creditor approval time in the transaction item is stamped with the latest creditor approval time. If all debitor approvals have timestamps, the latest timestamp is repeated as the debitor approval time. Not all debitor approvals are in, so this transaction item is not stamped with the debitor approval time. Finally, the transaction items are packed into a transaction and returned. To summarize, transaction items were received, the rule service found a transaction item rule and added tax transaction items. It then found the owners of the accounts referenced in those transaction items and added to each transaction item an empty approval for every account owner. The rule service also queried for approval rules and added timestamps where account owners wanted to automate their approval. When the service goes public, people are welcome to submit pull requests adding transaction item and approval rules to the repo. There's a rules module in the rules service with transaction item and approval submodules. That's where they'll land their commits. And no, there's no low-code rules engine plan. They cause more trouble than they solve. Requiring pull requests allows engineers to defend dry, composable, and testable transaction automation rules in code review and requirements. User opens an issue saying, "Our lawyer says you need to create an annuity rule." Engineer says, "Help yourself to the periodic transaction rule," and closes the issue. To develop the rule service, add code, then make rebuild rule to rebuild the container. Or if you don't want to wait for compose to rebuild the container while developing, shut down the compose stack with make compose down. Then from project root, CD into services rule, and make dev to trigger a local compile and app restart on file changes. You can shut that down along with Postgres and Docker in a separate shell, down into services rule, with make stop dev. In the next video, we'll move on to the request create service. You may subscribe, share, and contribute from the buttons and links in the description.